Good evening and welcome to this AZ Votes 2024 special edition of Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Tonight we feature a debate among Democrats running for Arizona's 3rd Congressional District. The district includes most of southern, western, and downtown Phoenix, along with a portion of Glendale. It is currently represented by Democrat Ruben Gallego, who is leaving the office to run for U.S. Senate. Candidates in tonight's debate will be given 90 seconds to reply to a question, and a 45-second rebuttal will be offered. Let's go ahead and introduce the candidates in alphabetical order. Yassamin Ansari, former Phoenix City Council member. Raquel Terán, former state senator and former chair of the State Democratic Party. And Dr. Duane Wooten, a pediatrician at the Wooten Healthcare Group. Let's get things started with opening statements. And again, in alphabetical order, we begin with Yassamin Ansari.
Good evening. My name is Yassamin Ansari. My parents came here in the 70s, fleeing persecution and a brutal regime in Iran. Growing up in Arizona, they instilled in me the values of hard work, education, and to never take democracy for granted. These lessons could not be more important today as extremist Republicans relentlessly attack our freedoms and our bodily autonomy. Our district deserves a Congresswoman who will fight and deliver real results for our community. As a senior advisor at the United Nations, I took on corporate polluters and helped to deliver the historic Paris Climate Agreement. As the youngest woman ever elected to the Phoenix City Council and as the vice mayor of our city, I protected abortion access and raised wages for thousands of workers. That's why I've been endorsed by the majority of labor unions in this race. It has been the honor of my life to serve Phoenix. And with your support, I cannot wait to keep delivering as your next Congresswoman.
All right, thank you very much. And we turn now to Raquel Terán.
Buenas tardes, Arizona. Good afternoon. Over the last two decades, I've been a community organizer. I'm a mother, the chair of the Arizona Democratic Party, campaign director for Planned Parenthood, and a legislator. And every single step of the way, I've been told that we cannot fight back the extremists. Yet, I led efforts to recall Russell Pierce, our Sheriff Arpaio, protect the Affordable Care Act, and under my leadership at the Arizona Democratic Party, we had historic victories that protected our democracy. I've listened to thousands of people in our district who have shared they're frustrated, they're mad because our freedoms are taken away. So that is why we are taking the fight to Congress. My campaign is supported by Senator Mark Kelly, Planned Parenthood, Reproductive Freedom for All, and 40,000 union members. I will be the first Latina to ever represent Arizona in Congress. I hope to count on your support. Visit RaquelTerán.com.
All right, thank you very much. And now the opening statement from Dr. Duane Wooten.
Good evening and good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Duane Wooten. I am a true native of Phoenix, Arizona, and a true native of the district that I want to serve. I've been serving in a capacity as a pediatrician for 40 years. This is my 40th year as a doctor serving my community. I was born and raised in Phoenix. I was educated in Phoenix. I went to Maryville High School after initially growing up in the Matthew Henson Housing Projects, where my office sits today. I have a passion to take care of people. And what I've witnessed over the last few decades is deplorable as far as taking care of people. We have many, many, many issues that we need to address in the long term, but we got some crisis going on in the short term. There are very few people that are running for office in any capacity that have the experience that I have in working together to get people to work together. And I bring that to the table, and I know that I can do a great job for you, my district, my home, in District 3.
All right, candidates, thank you very much. Ms. Ansari, Yassamin, we'll start with you. The most important issue in this district is?
I think the most important issue facing our country is extremism from the right. There's no question the attacks over the last several years, but really an ongoing attack over the last couple of decades on our freedoms, our bodily autonomy, our right to vote, our climate. These are the issues that are facing our nation. However, when I'm knocking doors every day in Congressional District 3, I do also feel that there is exhaustion with the political climate in which we're always fighting extremists, but not enough politicians are delivering. The biggest issues that people are facing on a day-to-day are about housing affordability, are about being able to pay their rent, are about the cost of education. And that's why, as a councilwoman and vice mayor, I made it my mission to actually deliver for people. We delivered new fire stations, new parks in our district in Levine and South Phoenix. We established a Phoenix Promise program to help hundreds of first-generation students go to college. I've been a housing champion at the Phoenix City Council, enacting zoning reform and building an unprecedented amount of affordable housing and missing middle housing in our city. That's the type of leadership you can expect from me in Congress, is someone who's not just going to fight against extremists, but pass policy that will benefit and tangibly improve the lives of our residents on a day-to-day.
Ms. Terán, number one issue in this district is?
Well, the issues that we hear in our community are many, but freedoms are the number one issue, is the number one issue that comes to mind. You know, last week, the Supreme Court enacted an 1864 abortion ban. It is wild that we're in this place right now. So reproductive freedoms are critical for us to fight for in Congress. And I will fight to make sure that we codify Roe. And let me tell you that the people that are most affected when you have these type of bans are the people from Congressional District 3 that don't necessarily have the resources to travel out of the state, to travel out of the country, to make sure they get their health care needs met. And these are the same people that, families that are struggling in our district to put food on the table, to make sure that they put gas in their car, and because they are the ones who are suffering because of the corporate greed and skyrocketing profits. And frankly, this is the time for us to make sure that we're fighting for everybody's freedoms.
Dr. Wooten, what is the top issue in this district as you see it?
The top issue in this district is easy. It is health care, housing affordability, and food disparities in the district. You know, people forget that the district that we want to serve has the highest disproportionate health care disparities seen in the country, let alone the state. I deal with kids, I deal with parents, and I deal with families every day of my career. And for 40 years, I've sat there and listened to politicians over the years say what they're going to do to support the community, what they're going to do to support West Phoenix. And this is why I'm running for office now, because I'm tired of hearing the lip service paid to this. People need food. There are 30% of all kids go to bed in my district food deprived. That is an alarming statistic, but it's the truth. We have people who have a concern about every night where they're going to sleep. We have a disproportionate amount of kids and adults that are homeless now. So people in my district are really worried about paying their bills, having adequate housing, and having adequate food sources. And that's what I want to focus on.
Ms. Ansari, as far as what we heard here, as far as the rebuttal is concerned, we got abortion and we got abortion rights and health care. Important issues, obviously, for everyone in the district. How important to you?
All of these issues are important. As a young woman, I was gutted by last week's decision when it came to abortion access in Arizona. I am fighting tooth and nail to make sure that we enshrine abortion access in our Constitution this November. But I also agree. I think when I was running my Phoenix City Council office, the vast majority of calls that we received were from families who were quite literally one paycheck away from going homeless. So I helped 19,000 families in Phoenix with rent and utility assistance. I helped direct over $140 million to build new emergency shelter beds and behavioral health services. I also helped to create new fresh food programs to get to our families. So I recognize these issues. I've actually delivered on these issues, and that's why I'm looking forward to taking that to Congress.
Ms. Terán, as far as healthcare, affordable access, healthcare, the whole nine yards here. You're going to Congress. You're not going to City Hall here, not Stone State Legislature. What can you do on Capitol Hill to address the people in this district regarding accessible and affordable healthcare?
Absolutely. I support Medicare for all. Look, we know that we have a healthcare system that is broken. Our families can bankrupt with one illness when they end up in the hospital. We saw it during the pandemic. People died because they did not want to go to the hospital because of the fear of how much it would cost. I'll tell you that personally in our family, we have a niece that has a rare disease. And once that disease was identified, we had to fight the insurance companies in order for her to get her treatment. And unfortunately, it's because of corporate greed. Once again, insurance companies taking over. So I believe that we need to have universal health care so that everybody can live a prosperous life.
Universal health care, Medicare for all, A, good ideas, B, how are you going to pay for it?
You know, I get asked this question all the time, being a physician. We have to have universal health care, but we need to understand what universal health care means. And it doesn't mean just having the ability to go to a physician, but it's having actual access and affordability. What does that mean? There are people who have access to health care who go to a physician, but they can't afford the medications that are prescribed. So when you talk about universal health care, you have to be all inclusive. And we in this country have done deplorably bad. We're number 33 to 34 in the world with delivery of health care, and that's just unacceptable.
And last point on this, Ms. Ansari, as far as Medicare is concerned, single payer, Medicare for all, again, how is this going to get paid for when Medicare itself is staring at insolvency?
You know, ironically, we're always talking about how we're going to pay for the things that are actually helping the people in America and in this district. We know that our tax system is completely unfair right now. The Trump tax cuts that are set to expire next year, there is a lot of opportunity there for reform to make sure that the middle class is paying less, but the wealthiest in this country and greedy corporations and billionaires need to pay their fair share so that we can invest elsewhere. We need to invest in Medicare for all. We need to invest in protecting and expanding Social Security, and we need to invest in our public schools, and that is of paramount importance. There's always a way to pay for good policy.
Dr. Wooten, I want to go to you for inflation here. The latest report, we're seeing the highest annual gain just a few days ago, highest annual gain in 6 months. Why? What's going on, and what can you do on Capitol Hill to fix it?
Well, we have to look at what the source is. The source of inflation, you know, we have, the average American has more expendable dollars now than they did 20 years ago. But unfortunately, the cost of goods is so high, and we have to look at why that's the case. And one of my colleagues here just used the word greed. It really comes down, in my opinion, to greed. Prices are exorbitant because people want to make maximum profit. There is no reason in the world right now that gas prices should be what they are. We're one of the leading, if not the leading, oil producer in the world right now, the United States of America. So why are gas prices so high? It comes down to greed. The same thing is regarding food. The food sources, it's unbelievable how much it costs just to get a bag of groceries nowadays. Why is that the case? It is not because of a shortage. It's because increased profitability. And, you know, until we get the word greed out of a lot of what we're talking about, we're going to have multiple problems, especially in things like healthcare delivery.
Inflation, Mr. Ron, I mean, what can be done about it?
You know, that at the end of the day, look, when I'm knocking on doors and people are saying that they're having to pay almost $4 for a gallon of milk, $5 for a dozen eggs, people are overwhelmed with this economic hardship. And yes, I agree, it's the greedy corporations, record profits, and skyrocketing prices. At the end of the day, have groceries, it doesn't cost as much to produce, but the corporations, unfortunately, are incredibly greedy. And I think we need to make sure that we're holding them accountable. There's so much corruption in Washington, D.C., and we need to make sure that we're holding corporations like this accountable. I'm happy that the Biden administration has used the ways of cracking down on monopolies to make sure that there's no more inflation.
What do you think, Ms. Ansari? Inflation.
I'm going to take this a step further. The reality is in this country that wages are also not keeping up with the cost of living, and there's a lot of greed in that realm as well. That's why on the Phoenix City Council, I was really proud to help lead the charge to raise wages for thousands of workers in our city, from police officers, firefighters, librarians, bus drivers, park rangers. You can imagine we have raised wages. We also became the first city in Arizona to enact a prevailing wage ordinance so that the hardworking individuals who are building our city can actually afford to keep living here. So there's greed across the board, and we have to make sure to stand with workers who are calling for more. And I'm proud to have actually taken action to improve their livelihoods on a daily basis. And that's what I'm going to do in Congress, fight for better wages, better benefits, and better working conditions.
Rebuttal?
Yeah, and I'm glad the councilwoman and the rest of the council, as well as the mayor, enacted a good ordinance for the workers. And it is because a lot of people in our state have been working to build power to ensure that there is a majority council in Phoenix, and that there is a power. Like Proposition 206 is what brought the ability to have that ordinance move through the city council, and it's happening all across the state, and it's due to a lot of people who have been working hard, engaging our communities to make sure that we have these type of propositions to get workers what they need.
There is a line of reasoning, though, Mr. Ryan, we'll start with you. There's a line of reasoning that raising those wages raises everything, that is a reason for inflation. There's also a line of reasoning that President Biden's policies, monetary policies, are in great part, the reason for the high prices. What say you?
Look, President Biden came in a time where we were leaving a pandemic, and he passed the Inflation Reduction Act, and that was Congress that enacted that. It was Democrats who moved that forward. Those type of policies have brought relief. Again, I think we need to look back at the fact that these greedy corporations are increasing prices and just keeping all the profits for themselves.
Dr. Wooten, Biden policies, monetary policies, and simple things like increasing the wage by way of government as opposed to the market, as some would argue it should be done, that these are among the many reasons that prices are so high. Do they have a point?
They have a small point. I mean, but you have to look at the ideology of why. And as Raquel just said, it is very well said, that when Biden took over, we're in a significant crisis. To jumpstart this economy, to save this economy, things had to be done that cost a lot of money. So we can't forget from where we came, and we came from a pandemic that almost had us under. So yes, there were some increased costs that needed to be shared appropriately throughout the country that really, frankly, has not been done. And so the middleman, the middle class, and the lower class are the ones that hurt from it.
Ms. Ansari, for those who say Biden policies are to blame here, you say?
I disagree. I think we have to remember the context, the global pandemic, the war in Ukraine, many issues that are causing rising inflation. I think Biden policies have been instrumental in helping working families get through these very difficult times. And to the question of wages, I fundamentally disagree that I believe that we need to increase wages. I've been working very closely with our workers at the airport at the city of Phoenix. There have been comprehensive studies done that show that none of these individuals can survive on the one job that they have. They need to work multiple jobs. They're food insecure, they're housing insecure, and this is unacceptable in the United States of America.
Ms. Ansari, we'll stick with you here. Immigration, is there a border security crisis? And whether it's a yes or a no, what needs to be done regarding immigration on a federal level?
So as the daughter of immigrants, I am so proud of this community of immigrants and self-starters. And if it wasn't for the United States being welcoming when my parents were facing persecution, I would not be sitting here today. I think when it comes to the border, there is no question in my mind that there are a lot of political games being played. It's no question that Donald Trump sowed chaos most recently, and there was a bipartisan bill on the table supported by our president, supported by our current congressman. And Donald Trump is the reason we don't have that. I think when it comes to the border and when it comes to comprehensive immigration reform, we have to move beyond political games and we have to elect lawmakers who actually want to get things done. The basics, we know we have to support our border communities. We know they are understaffed, they are underfunded and need more support. We also know that we need legal pathways to immigration for the thousands of dreamers and undocumented immigrants in this country, from temporary farm workers to the Afghan refugees who've come to this country over the last couple of years who supported our military and are now in flux because we can't get comprehensive immigration reform in the books. With me, you can count on someone who's able to work with both sides of the aisle. That's going to be critical in Congress. It's not just about working with Democrats. You need to work with independents and Republicans and get things done.
Ms. Terán, is there a crisis at the border?
Look, I was born on the border. I was born in Douglas, raised in the Mexican side of the border. The issue that got me started in organizing and Arizona politics is the need for comprehensive immigration reform. We need to make sure that we solve this in a comprehensive manner, that we're able to provide a pathway to citizenship for the 11 million people that are here who are working here in the fields to the doctor's office. We need a solution for dreamers that is a final and real solution. And the border, you know, the border needs the resources. The communities at the border need the resources to address the humanitarian crisis that we are experiencing, because we are experiencing a humanitarian crisis and it needs to be addressed. The ports of entry need to have the resources necessary to keep us safe. And I am not going to lower my standards or my expectations to ensure that we do get comprehensive immigration reform. Republicans keep fear-mongering and using this issue as a wedge issue. And Donald Trump has already committed to deport, to go into massive deportations. And if we learn anything from his commitment of reversing Roe, we need to believe that he would, if elected, he would potentially deport millions of people, and we need to make sure that we are in the majorities and get comprehensive immigration reform done.
Dr. Wooten, is there a crisis at the border, and what can Congress do? What can you do in Congress to address it?
Well, first of all, identify the fact that it's truly a crisis at the border. But, you know, in medicine, we always look at the etiology. What, why is something going on? And I hate to say this, and I will not use a former president's name. If you notice, I don't say his name at all, because it is a self-perpetuating crisis. It's a crisis. We have to do a comprehensive border security, border control, et cetera. But we don't need to weaponize the individuals that are coming to seek asylum to cross our borders in a fair and equitable way. And it's sad to say, but we look at certain individuals as really the pariahs, and we look at other individuals who want to come into this country from other ports, other areas, and we don't even think about them as being in that same state. They're still immigrants. We should treat them all with respect and dignity, especially the children that are coming across our borders.
Now, sticking with you, Dr. Wooten, Tucson sector had 370,000 crossings last year. That's up 120,000 from the year before. Good, bad, indifferent?
Bad. We got to do something about that. There's no question we have to get more control on our border crossings. But we have to do it in a way that, again, like I said, is respectful with dignity. We don't have to treat human individuals as if there's some bad people. That's the only words I'll use. You work across the aisle and you work with people, you can come up with solutions if you work together. Our problem in Congress is that they just haven't been able to work together, nor have they wanted to work together.
Ms. Ansari, you hear those numbers? What do you think when you hear those numbers?
I hear that we need more resources. I mean, in my first answer, I said we need resources for the border and resources for the departments in this country that are managing the border. We know that asylum laws in this country were written many, many years ago, and it is valid to say that you should look at these laws and the resources we need to make sure to be able to track all of these cases and understand the legitimacy of asylum cases. We have to do this in a humanitarian way. We always want to be the country that's attracting the best and the brightest and individuals to come to the United States. But without real leaders who want to work together to get something done, it's just not going to happen.
What do you think, Ms. Terán?
You know, I'm going to go back to comprehensive immigration reform. This needs to be addressed in a comprehensive manner. You know, we do have many people that are coming to this country because they're fleeing climate crisis, they're fleeing violence, they're fleeing economic hardship. And we are a nation of immigrants, and we should be welcoming, and we should have the resources necessary to attend this crisis.
Just to interrupt here, when you say comprehensive immigration reform, all-encompassing, can you not take it step by step, or does it have to be comprehensive?
Well, I think it's important that we take it in a comprehensive manner. And we did see a bill that was in front of the Senate, and I know that we need the resources for the border, but if we are not attending the crisis that we already have with people who are here, 11 million people who are here undocumented, it will be harder to get to that place.
Hey, real quickly, running out of time, comprehensive or nothing at all? What do you think?
I support comprehensive immigration reform, but I do not believe that we should give up any sort of progress, all or nothing. We've been in this situation for decades. People have been talking about comprehensive immigration reform for decades. We need it, but we also need resources right now. And when there's compromise on the table, I believe we can't let a Donald Trump screw that up.
Okay, very quickly, a comprehensive or nothing at all? What do you think?
Comprehensive, of course. And like I said, it was put on the table. It could be voted on tomorrow. They refused to do it. We have it.
All right, candidates, thank you so much. Time now for closing statements. And again, going in alphabetical order, we start with Yassamin Ansari.
From the United Nations to the Phoenix City Council, I have taken on extremists and delivered results at every juncture of my career. When the Supreme Court came for our bodily autonomy, I took action at the Phoenix City Council to protect doctors and patients in our city. I have passed actual policy with real-world impacts on climate change, job creation, public safety, and housing affordability. I'm sitting here today because of my parents. I've dedicated my life's work to public service because this country welcomed them with open arms and opportunity when they desperately needed it. Our community deserves somebody who's going to stand up and fight, but actually bring back resources and deliver for this district. My name is Yassamin Ansari, and I'm asking for your vote so that we can finish this work the same way we started it, together.
Thank you. And now the closing statement from Raquel Terán.
Well, this is what democracy looks like. Thank you for the conversation. You know, people like me have been told many times that we don't belong. You're an activist, you don't have $1 million to run a congressional race, put your head in the sand, don't shake things up. Frankly, that is what many people in our district hear many times. And I've never let that stop me, much like them. So in 2006, when I was handed a clipboard with voter registration forms as a form to bring immigration reform, comprehensive immigration reform, worker rights, I was ready for the battle. I have been working hard to make sure that our state is different and that we provide, that we build power so that we can get what our families need in Arizona. I will be the first Latina to ever represent Arizona in Congress. I ask for your support, that you join our coalition, the one of Senator Mark Kelly, Planned Parenthood, Reproductive Freedom for All, the League of Conservation Voters, and many others. Join us at RaquelTeran.com.
Thank you. And now the closing statement from Dr. Duane Wooten.
I knew at age 7 that I wanted to be a pediatrician. I then made it my life's goal to get into my community and do what I could do to make life better for people. And I've been doing it now for 40 years as a physician. I was the youngest doctor in the history of the state of Arizona when I became a graduate of the University of Arizona College of Medicine after attending Northwestern University in Chemical and Biomedical Engineering at age 16. I have been an activist for a lot of years. I was age 5 when I was marching for civil rights down Jefferson Avenue with my grandfather, who was a minister here in this town for 50 years. I know how to bring people together, and I know how to problem solve. I've been doing it all my life, and I've dedicated my entire life to this community. So I'm asking you to consider some fresh blood, somebody who has the expertise to bring people together and make a true difference in this community.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, candidates, and thank you for watching tonight's debate. Our next Arizona Horizon debate will be this Thursday, April 18th, as we hear from Republican candidates vying to represent Arizona's 4th Congressional District. That's Thursday, April 18th at 5 p.m. and 10 p.m. right here on Arizona Horizon. And you can watch all of our shows live on ArizonaPBS.org or stream live on YouTube and Facebook. That's it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.